Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Pereira. According to the latest release by the Central Statistics Office, about 4,96,000 crore rupees worth of milk was produced by farmers in 2014-15. The figure takes into account the value of milk production across all the states of the country. This is for the first time that the value of milk has exceeded the total value of food grains. The data was part of CSO's report on the gross value of output of agriculture and allied sectors for the years 2011-12 to 2014-15. The value of food grains, which includes cereals and pulses produced, stood at 4,87,000 crore rupees. The value of output was above paddies, which came in at 2,26,000 crores, and wheat at 1,29,000 crore rupees. Earlier, milk production was not even close to the value of food grains and wheat production. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze if the government should take a relook at its farm priorities. Joining me on the program today are Harish Damodaran, Rural Affairs Editor of the Indian Express, Tajamul Haque, former Chairman, Commission for Agricultural Cost and Prices, Professor Ramesh Chand, Member, Agriculture NITI Aayog, and B.K.Tyagi, Scientist. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. I'd like to start with Harish Damodaran first, because he's the journalist who, in fact, wrote about this story and brought this story out into the public domain. You know, Harish Damodaran, what did you see when you looked at this story and brought this story? What was your highlight, really?
No, I think our government policy is still fixated on cereals, and, you know, it is still, you know, I think it's in the 20th century. Whereas I think agriculture today is far more diversified than what it was. You know, it is no longer just cereal. It is, as you talked about, it is milk, it is meat, you know, it's fish. And this is very natural, because even the consumer is no longer wants just calories and carbohydrates. You know, he wants a more, he or she wants a more diversified diet. You know, and probably the government policy is very slow to, you know, respond to this. Like you look at, for example, the current year's union budget. The total allocation for the Department of Agriculture and Cooperation is, I think, something like 41,000 crore, whereas for Department of Animal Husbandry, Dairying and Fisheries, it's hardly some 2,100 crore, you know. And all over, if you see, even state budgets, you know, there's hardly, you know, hardly about 10%, you know, would be for, I mean, I think the total allocations for livestock is probably not even, you know, 5% of what it is for general agriculture. And same thing, like, even if you look at our research priorities, there is very little research going on to, you know, on fodder development, for example. You know, like I know that Tamil Nadu Agricultural University has been doing a lot of work on developing, you know, high protein fodder, you know, but we hardly see it in the rest of the country. You know, I think we are still very much in that wheat and paddy kind of framework, and probably we need to recognize this whole thing, and milk itself, I think we should look at it as the entire livestock sector, you know. So it cannot be just milk, it has to be also meat, it also has to be, you know, leather, you know, so it has to be an integrated thing. And we are really losing an opportunity, you know, because we have such a large stock of bovine cattle, you know. So we need to see milk, livestock, and meat together as an integrated whole, and that is how I think, and that is the future, you know, because our milk consumption is going to increase a lot. You know, India is primarily a vegetarian country, but it is lacto-vegetarian. You know, the moment your incomes rise, the first thing which the consumption will rise is milk. You know,
sure, and, right. I'm going to take the point that you're making forward. You know, milk, the demand for milk is only going to increase, and that's where we're going to see the agricultural industry moving towards. You know, Professor Chand, I'd like to bring you into the picture. You know, we've realized that milk is an integral part of our society. It's a very important part of what we do on a daily basis as well. But still, the rise of milk seems to be going unnoticed. Why is that so?
No, I don't think it is going unnoticed. You see, there are some commodities which require different type of support, and I will say that one of the factors for faster growth of dairy sector in India is that this sector is much more liberalized compared to the kind of intervention we have in food grain in other categories. So if we always feel that government support is not coming, so sometime you will find that in the name of government support, this kind of support which comes, it may put a check on the growth of the sectors. Like in milk sector, we have no restriction on marketing, we have no restriction on entry of private sector, FDI, any kind of thing. But you look at the crop sector, there are so many restrictions. Farmer cannot sell outside APMC, there are APMC rules, all those kind of things. So my own feel is that if this dairy sector has been kept outside many of the regulation of government, that has come to the help of the dairy sector.
Is there something we can learn from it then?
Yeah, I have written on it that if we liberalized our horticulture sector also, like dairy sector, that we allow aggregators, we promote sale of vegetable fruit within village. So you will find that and characteristics between horticulture and milk are common both from demand side as well as from supply side. So I agree with the Damodaran to some extent that if you start looking at this subsidies, price support, you will find certainly its content is much higher in crop sector compared to livestock sector. But I think livestock sector has got more favorable environment because in 2003 government decided to change the milk and milk product order. So it is that which has played a major role. Then institution of cooperatives, then you see we can't ignore role of Amul, role of National Dairy Development Board, which are the public sector initiatives. But I agree with him that infrastructure in livestock is much poorer compared to what we are doing in crop sector in terms of extension, in terms of public support, in terms of institutional credit. But still, there is something I think which we need to admire, that it is a demand pull growth.
Okay. Okay. So the demand has increased. So that's why there is growth also in that particular sector is what you're suggesting. Changing times then, Tajamul Haque, do we also need to look at how things are changing and then look at them seriously? For instance, do you believe that more credit as well as more attention needs to be given to the dairy sector?
I think attention is being given at present. If you see, that is one of the priority areas of the government. And if you see for the last few several years, I should say one decade or so, the livestock sector, in particularly the dairy, has done exceedingly well in terms of growth. That has been the major source of income growth in most of the regions of the country. It is not just one or two regions. But then, even then, if you see this kind of average figures, like whatever you are saying, 18% to 20% or whatever for dairy, it is not that everywhere that is the kind of contributions of dairy sector. It is only concentrated in Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan, to some extent UP, and Bihar has done recently exceedingly well. And one of the contributory factors to this growth, again I should say, the cooperative sector. And in fact, in the case of Bihar, earlier people used to say nothing can happen in Bihar. But Sudha cooperatives in Bihar made that kind of change. In fact, in 20 districts of Bihar, there is a milk revolution. So I think all these institutional factors plus, liberalization kind of atmosphere or environment that is there, unlike some of the commodity sectors that we have. So I think things are doing well. But again, as I say, not everywhere this is doing well. In fact, West Bengal, you don't see so much of milk. Orissa, I think, I remember about 20, 30 years back, I participated in one conference where Ramesh Chand was there. And he went with his family and he was searching for milk in the morning for his son. So this was the situation. But now Orissa also, you get milk everywhere. So things are changing all over. So I don't say that the government, it is not the priority of the government. But then there are certain critical constraints. One thing is that infrastructure of veterinary care, that is lacking in almost all the states other than a few states. As I said, Punjab, Haryana is relatively better. UP also has done a little better these days. But then otherwise, on the whole, veterinary care centers have been very inadequate. Similarly, the fodder, feed and fodder, there is a lack of quality feed, and also fodder area under fodder also is not that much, because keeping in view the importance of growing livestock sector. So I think these things need to be attended to, particularly in areas where it is not doing so well. In the case of fruits and vegetables, again, you find only the hilly regions and also the northeastern regions, and to some extent West Bengal has done exceedingly well. In fact, as compared, if you see their contributions relatively, but not that everywhere you have this pattern. You need to do it, because as your income increases, you need to, you know, spend more on, or rather, there's a trend, established trend all over.
Right.
That you spend more on milk, fruits, vegetables, and even some other, you know, meat and things like eggs, things like that. But then I will not, you know, blindly or blanketly say that it is not the priority of the government. It is the priority of the government. Government is, you know, to, everywhere, wherever you go, people say that at least small luminaries and, you know, goat, your sheep, including poultry, I think in some cases they are doing exceedingly well. So that these are the things which you need to, you know, to almost all farms in all villages.
Sure.
So that will bring about the kind of change that we need.
Sure, sure. B.K.Tyagi, how do you extend this to, you know, beyond its present reach? How do you ensure that, you know, the income improves and the condition of farming or the allied sector too improves?
I think it's bound to improve, because in agriculture policy, we had, you know, that perspective, how to tackle the globalization and liberalization thing, which the changes which is occurring here. And in fact, this the increased production, especially in the milk, vegetable and fruits, I should say it's in a response to that process which has taken up here economically. Because see, if doing the traditional agriculture, especially when we are producing cereals and all that, it has a lot of, you know, very longer gestation period, then inputs are more, and the risk factor is always there. So in addition to that, the farmer has taken up this the milk, and besides that, the government policies has, you know, supported the process. As a result, the cooperative movement, even cooperative movement is fortunately or unfortunately not strong in all the states, but just the incentive here is, even where the cooperative movement is not there, you're getting, you know, quick return at least monthly, which in doing in traditional agriculture, it's not there. So this has the biggest motivation factor, which has, you can say, bringing this white revolution, which we call it. Here, you know, the money circulation with the farmer is that period is very less, at least monthly, and the investment is also not huge, the risk is not huge. But here I think we need, like, veterinary services, like the way we have done in Anand. Like for if the cow or the animal is not well, immediately we had a medical recourse to that. This is still not, you know, that optimal. Even I have seen the example in Himachal Pradesh also. It's also very good, but it has not been extended, especially in other area where we had this green revolution. But farmers are taking up. They have not means like it is an now additional venture. So which has, which is giving them a additional, you know, surplus money in terms of in their hand, which was for that, unfortunately, the government policy of procurement, the infrastructure, the storage facility, that always never kept, you know, like a pace with the demand. We always had a slightly a. So here it came a you know, a very opportunistic time, you know, the whole thing, which could be a, which was a very doable proposition.
Sure.
So from, if we look at this from the farmer's angle, this was to me the most probable reason for this increase. This,
okay.
Besides the support of the government policy, that's always there. Yeah.
Sure. You know, Harish Damodaran, you did mention in your opening statements that it is not just milk, but horticultural produce, fisheries, meat, poultry and everything. You know, there has been a considerable rise over the last decade or so. Could this rise also be attributed to the fact that the dietary needs of the consumers have changed over the last decade or so, and that's why we've seen the sudden rise in some of the items that I've just mentioned?
See, the farmer always responds to price signals. In fact, he does it much faster than anybody else. You know, like for example, we know that when arhar prices, you know, shot through the roof, he immediately increased the area under arhar, and then prices crashed. You know, so the farmer is essentially he or she is responding to the market demand. You know, and the job of government policy should be to enable him to respond to this. And I totally agree with Professor Ramesh Chand that the government should try not to do try to do too much of regulations. And I think we are now beginning to see this regulation happening in the form of, you know, movement of livestock. You know, the farmer should be able to, you know, to sell his livestock freely, buy new livestock. You know, that kind of thing should be there. You know, because without churning his animals, he will not be able to optimize the milk production and this kind of thing. So I think nowadays we are seeing this regulation coming by, and it is very much possible that you know, because of this could impede, I think, the supply of milk in the long run. You know, so I think what Professor Ramesh Chand is saying is very, very correct. So probably dairying so far benefited thanks to not too much of restrictions, at least on pricing and, you know, these kind of things. And going forward, I believe that, you know, farmers should go more and more for, you know, commercial dairying. And when I'm saying commercial dairying, it doesn't mean, you know, 1,000 animals and 2,000 animals. Say you can have about 30 animals. You know, you can have about 5 acres where you grow fodder. You know, and the beauty about milk is, you know, you can sell round the year. You know, you have daily income. You know, unlike putting all your money in, say, cotton or groundnut, and then that crop failing. You know, and plus it is very labor intensive. Like for example, if you go to Gujarat, for example, there are many farmers who were earlier, you know, just pure who had no experience, like especially in the Adivasi belt of the Dangs. You know, they had no history, they had no tradition of animal husbandry. I mean, in the sense of dairying. But today they've all moved to modern dairying. You know, they've gone, they use artificial insemination, they use concentrate feed, and they have turned out to be very good dairy farmers. So sure, you could do the same thing in Chhattisgarh and in many places, you know, and probably this is the best way to fight even whatever, you know, left-wing extremism, you know, the Nexel kind of a threat. Because once you have daily income, and actually we should understand, why is it that in Gujarat there are so few farmer suicides? I think the main reason is because almost every farmer there supplies to Amul. You know,
okay,
so when you
right
have this,
you
kind
know
of a regular daily income, you know, I think that is probably better than any whatever crop insurance and this kind of a thing. So
sure,
so I think this is a sector we need to promote. And yes, and the government should think before it you know, goes into too much of regulation, you know, both
okay
into pricing as well as livestock movement and sales and that kind of a thing.
Right. Okay. You know, a couple of contentious issues raised by Harish Damodaran. I don't know if you're going to get into that at the moment. But looking forward, you know, one thing is certain, Professor, that, you know, the roadblocks need to be minimized and
mm-hmm
ensure free trade mm-hmm between farmers so as to ensure that, you know, produce can be sold in the open market. And we hope we move towards that at sometime sooner rather than later. But can this model be you know, applied to other sectors as well to see the similar kind of success?
Mm-hmm. No, we are already pleading to allow similar kind of model to be applied in the case of fruit and vegetables, both in terms of liberalization and also in terms of institutional support of cooperative and that processing. You see, if this processing facility in milk sector had not come, big milk plant of cooperative or private sector, Nestle and all, everywhere private sector has also come in a big way, then you will find that this growth would probably not have happened. But while it is appreciable that growth of livestock is much higher than crop sector, and government is promoting, now we have for the first time National Gokul Mission. Lot of things are being done under that, new National Dairy Plan. So things are being done under that, but we should also acknowledge that one of the factors for high growth of milk is the increase in number of livestock. In case of crop sector, you can't increase area, rather it is shrinking. But if you look at the number of livestock, that has been increasing, which is not a sustainable way of having increase in production, because increase in number of livestock number put all kind of pressure on natural sources, climate change and things like that. So in future, in order to sustain this kind of growth, we have to rely more and more on productivity increase and less on the increase in the number of livestock.
Sure.
So that's why this this national Gokul mission mainly aiming at improving productivity of indigenous cattle also paying attention to small ruminant like goat and sheep and also poultry and those kind of things. So as you raised this question in the beginning, that is it that need for this kind of commodity is rising? I will say it is not the need, it is the dietary preference. Hmm. So globally, if you observe at dietary transition, when per capita income of people rise, they tend to shift away from cereal and go more and more for livestock product and horticulture product. Hmm. In India, there is a slightly different pattern. In India, the rate of meatification of diet is much slower compared to the rate at which this demand for vegetable and fruit, right, etc. Is happening. And that has implication for cereal demand. Faster the meatification of diet, more the cereal you require for conversion of food into, to feed. So
right,
that kind of thing is not happening in India. Here diversification toward livestock product is happening, but at a much slower rate,
pace, yes,
than what you have seen in other countries.
True. You know, Mr. Haque, do we need a major policy overhaul as far as the agricultural sector is concerned, as the needs of the consumer and the farmers too are changing with changing times?
One thing, as you said, if you leave it to market, the growth that has happened, as you rightly said, Professor Ramesh Chand, that, I mean, the open environment, the role of the private sector, role of the farmers' cooperatives themselves, I think that those things have played a very important role. So again, if you talk of policies, in fact, government believes in that kind of framework, like in an open framework in which, you know, everybody gives their best and utilizes the maximum potential that is there. So I think there is no problem on the policy front, as I would say particularly. The problem is that you need huge investment to create those kind of infrastructures. Like what happens, even if it is a demand driven, if you are close to the urban centers, you are able to sell your product quickly at a higher price than if you are in a remote areas. So how do you connect your remote areas to the urban centers with good road connectivity and good transportation system, cool chain system and things like that? Those things will help, and those things need investment. And for investment to come, as you know, I think we have some problems, of course, because of availability of total amount that is needed to do the tricks in terms of achieving accelerated growth in all these sectors. But efforts are being made currently, so I don't think, you know, policy priorities are not there. Yeah. Priorities are there, and slowly as your resource mobilization takes place, probably more and more investment will take place, because it is demand driven. There is a demand from the farmers that they should have a regular income source, and there cannot be anything better than milk, as Harish also said. And also similarly, in the case of fruits and vegetables, it is a good source of income, but then problem is that the price fluctuations is so much in the market for fruits and vegetables that farmers find it sometimes very risky, particularly small and marginal farmers.
Yes.
Can't find and can't cope with this kind of things unless there is an insurance system or some such other alternatives. So I think those problems are there, but otherwise I think we are likely to do much better.
Okay, we are likely to do much better in the days to come, is what you're suggesting. You know, B.K.Tyagi, do we need a holistic approach as far as agriculture is concerned in this country?
Yes, definitely, because if we look at the policy is, you can say, a set of ideals. It's a question of like how we are implementing it. I think all the aspect which we need, you know, it is covered in the policy, all starting from infrastructure, increasing the productivity, giving specific emphasis, insurance, safety, all aspect, I think it has been mentioned in that. Now the question is how we are implementing it. Do we again going by sector-wise approach or as a holistic? Because agriculture, if we say, like, still contributing a very substantial portion of to the GDP, and considering the number of people which are involved in that, I think direct agriculture and allied sector, they also be strengthened further. It should not only like because many farmers. If we see like fisheries, many farmers, they are converting their cultivable land to for fisheries or even for this saline culture. So that means we are destroying that land. So I think the policy should address that also, like what is the specific need, and providing creating an environment of security, not only for security but emotional security to the farmers also. That in case of any failure, whatever you are doing, that there is a backup plan also for you, because this is the most you can say a gap area where even at the implementation level policies are there, but when it comes to finally giving a relief to the farmer in case of failure of the crop and all that, it never come timely or it's not appropriate what is required. I think this is the area where we need a definite focus. And effort also.
Okay, I've got 2 minutes left on the program. Quick closing comments from all my guests, beginning with you, Harish Damodaran. How do we secure the future of, how do we secure our agricultural future?
I think we should accept the fact that a farmer will not produce many things. You know, he or she must specialize. Like, for example, I think the future of the dairy farmer is as a pure dairy farmer, not as a mixed farmer, which is not possible. A basmati farmer will basically do basmati plus maybe wheat.
Okay.
So I think we have to move more and more into specialization.
Fair enough. Point taken.
And that will bring in more the economies of scale and I think that is very much possible.
Okay. Specialization is what you're suggesting. Let me get closing comments from my other guests as well. Professor Chand, what happens to traditional farming?
No, you see, traditional farming will remain there in some segment, but not in the form of, but be say pure traditional farming kind of things. But I would like to say that in the concluding remarks that we need to learn from the success of dairy sector in this country, and the lesson from there is let private sector play their role in value addition, in marketing, and in taking technology to the farm.
Tajamul Haque, do we need to invest in infrastructure going forward?
Yes, that is what I've already mentioned, that you need to invest adequately in terms of creating adequate number of veterinary cares in all clusters of villages. Second thing is, as I said, you also need to produce not just infrastructure, produce adequate quality feed and fodder. And second thing is, I will particularly say that the transportation, marketing, that part. Otherwise, again, there is a limit beyond which you will not be able to grow. So this is one. But another very important thing, as Professor Ramesh Chand already mentioned, that you need to improve the productivity of your cattle, buffalo, all this very substantially. Otherwise, you'll be sometime it does not become a remunerative kind of situation for farmers. They don't make anything out of that, even though they sell. And additionally, at the aggregate level, you find so much is the contribution. But at the farm level, there are real difficulties.
Okay. B.K.Tyagi, in one sentence, your closing, concluding remark.
Yeah. Definitely, I think we need the improvement of infrastructure, and also like not specialization, because Indian culture is Indian agriculture society is altogether different. But definitely, like whatever the S&T new inputs is coming, we have to strengthen the training of the farmer or information awareness creation among them.
Specialization and training is the outcome. Infrastructure is something that we need to invest in as well. On that note, we'll call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. I'd like to thank all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. That's all the time we have today. See you again next time.